the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophets, behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way for you, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. John came baptizing in the wilderness and preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Then all the land of Judea and those from Jerusalem went out to him and were baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey, and he preached, saying, there comes one after me who is mightier than I, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to stoop down and loose. I indeed baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Glory to Jesus Christ.
Glory forever.
So we hear today, this Sunday before the Theophany, the Sunday before the baptism of our Lord Jesus Christ, the prophecy. Behold the voice one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. What does that prophecy mean? I mean, think about this. I mean, you know, make the Lord's path straight. You know, anybody who has had children and has had to walk through the house in, you know, these weird ways to not step on all the Legos and the toys and all of those things that have been left in the middle of the floor, that's kind of the implication. Make his way straight. Make that Lord. Make his path straight that he may come without having to spend any extra effort. His effort is just merely walking from here to greet you. And we must do that in our heart. And to do that, we must heed the call of John. You know, traditionally, over in Iconostas, in the older form, what was right above the royal doors was not the Last Supper. It was an icon of the judgment. And that is, you know, not dissimilar to this icon that's actually here, the Pantocrator, behind the altar. But there would be Christ, and on this side would be, on his right, and over here is John the Baptist. That was what was right over there. It's John the Baptist. And to prepare the way of the Lord, we must heed John's call. Repent. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. This is the call, and this is what it means for us to prepare the way of the Lord, to make his path straight. And we must then repent. And what does it mean to repent? You know, the Orthodox world doesn't quite have the same understanding that the typical American understanding of repentance is. Oh, I just have to go feel bad about things. I'm here to be judged and to feel bad about it. No, that isn't repentance. You can feel bad about something, right on doing it. Because you haven't found repentance and you haven't found healing. Repentance is hard work. Repentance is challenging work. Repentance is self-reflection. It's not just, well, I sinned, and I did this sin. We have to understand that we're not going to do that sin again. Sometimes through the grace of God, it can be just like flipping a switch. And we've decided, that's it. Through Christ's strength, I'm not doing that anymore. Through Christ's strength, I'm going a different direction. And sometimes we can say those words, but yet we keep finding ourselves in the same situations, committing the same sins. And this is where repentance truly and deeply comes in. Because to repent sometimes means, well, I keep doing the same thing. Let me find out why. What thought process? The logismi is the Greek word. Thoughts. What thoughts am I having that keep leading me down this direction? Why do I keep falling into the same trap? Sometimes it's because the Lord allows us to. But oftentimes it's because we just, you know, we talk about Christ, we talk about our orthodoxy, we talk about our faithfulness, and that's about as far as it goes. We talk. We talk. And we talk. Well, my grandpa did this, and my dad did that. Well, that's wonderful. What have you done today? What have you done for yourself? Because God, as they say, has no grandchildren. We are all children of God. We are all sons by adoption. I know some people will actually say that's not very inclusive language when the church says sons by adoption. It's more inclusive than we can begin to comprehend. Because when that rule was written, it declared everyone a son of God. And when that rule was written in that culture, in that society, both in the ancient world, really well up until the modern era, only the sons could inherit anything. So when everyone is declared a son of God, everyone is an inheritor of the kingdom. Everyone is an inheritor of the kingdom. But every one of us is also set forth right here with the task, not of the prodigal. I mean, those who are watching, those who are listening to the sermons, those who are coming on a regular basis, we're not the prodigal. We are the older son. We are the older son in that story. Because remember the story of the prodigal. He went out, he squandered his father's living, took half of his inheritance early, wasted it, partied it away, drank it away, drugged it away, caroused it away, and came back home. And when he came home, the father greeted him. The father ran to greet him. Said, "Kill the fatted calf. My son who has lost is found. He has repented. He has turned from his evil ways." Of course, now I'm adding in, I'm defining this. I'm giving the commentary on the scripture. He's turned from his evil ways. He's returned to the right path. And this is a cause for rejoicing and celebration. Kill the fatted calf. Throw a big party. Because he who is lost is found. He was gone astray, has found the path. We're not that person. Those of us who are coming and watching and serving on a regular basis, we're the older son. We're the older son who kind of resents this whole thing. You know, that guy's screwed everything up. He took half the inheritance. He took his half of everything, and he parted it away. He walked away. He left me to do all the work. You know, because anybody who's grown up around farming families, if you're a member of the farming family, you're working. He parted it away. I stayed and worked. I busted my butt. I lost everything. By losing half of the land, we weren't able to continue to expand it more. We weren't able to invest that portion of the land into more flocks, more crops, more all of the things that we need to do to grow the barns, to grow the farms. So he's resentful. He's outside. He hasn't come into the celebration. And that's where we are, outside. We haven't come in. We're looking at the whole thing. We're hearing the story of repentance. We're watching the people who repent and sitting there with judgment. Well, I didn't do all that stuff. I mean, why is that guy celebrated? I've been doing this, and I've been doing that, and I have this, and I. And, you know, we hear this. Anybody who's been around parish councils for a while has heard this kind of stuff. Yet the Father comes out and says, you've always been with me, and you have all my love, and then some. Come and celebrate. Your brother who is lost is found. In essence, this party is for you too. You've never left. This party is yours as much as his. Even though we're celebrating his return after a mighty fall and some horrific, horrific screw-ups. This party is yours too. Now you can either stand outside him. I'm going to sound like dad here. My children are going to roll their eyes at this part of the sermon. You can either stand outside and pout about it, or come in and celebrate with us. This is your party too, not just mine. So we are stuck with the same point as God. Are we going to stand outside and pout? Which tells us that we are just as much on the wrong path as the brother who was lost, as the prodigal son. Are we the son out standing outside pouting, or are we going to come in and celebrate? Someone who's lost is found, and that joy is great in heaven. And we should share that joy. And we should also come in and partake of the fatted calf. This is what repentance is. We must hear that call. We must set aside our ego, our personal wants and needs, and I don't like that guy, and I don't like the other thing, and this hasn't happened, and I'm not going in.